so we gon' walk it out. Ooh.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us today on the Truth and the Sojourn podcast. With us today is the esteemed Mrs. Jean Farmer Butterfield, former North Carolina House of Representative, who now serves on the North Carolina Board of Unemployment. Mm-hmm. And also joining us today is one of her daughters, Mrs. Valeisha Butterfield Jones, who is the first Chief Diversity of, first Chief Diversity and Inclusion Officer for the Recording Academy. Ladies, welcome, and thank you so much for joining me today on the Truth and the Sojourn podcast. I appreciate y'all taking time out of your schedules to chat with me today. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I keep wanting to say Director Butterfield, but
some people call me Director. Some people call me Commissioner. It doesn't matter.
the accoutrement is long, I understand, but I you are definitely a servant within your community and beyond your community. But I will start with you, if we could, ma'am. How did you manage rearing and raising girls in the somewhat rural South, which is Wilson, North Carolina, all while taking care of home and navigating the waves of the political arena?
Well, I was very involved in politics from high school. Really, I got involved with my mother. I watched my mother at her kitchen table as I was growing up, helping people learn how to read the preamble to the North Carolina Constitution, so that they could exercise their right to vote. And if they could not read, she actually taught them how to memorize it. And if they needed transportation to the polls, of course, my mom got my dad to make the arrangements and get people to the polls to exercise their right to vote. Then in high school, I was president of the student government. And I worked in several campaigns at the local, state, and national levels. And most of the people for whom I worked as a candidate won. So I raised my daughters. I decided that that was the priority. And when they finished high school and the position for North Carolina House of Representatives opened up, Senator Fitz left the position. At that time, he was the representative for many years, and his term was filled, an unexpired term, by a gentleman who's in Rocky Mount, Shelley Willingham. And after Shelley Willingham filled the term, I ran for election to the position because several people in the community came to me and asked me to run. Mm-hmm. And they said, you're the one to run for this position because of your history, your involvement, mm-hmm. and you have a pretty good, clean record, integrity, character, etc. So I tried to live the kind of life that my daughters would be proud of. I was divorced, and I had decided I wasn't going to remarry because I didn't want someone to move in with me and my daughters and take away from their independence and freedom. You never know who people are until you really, really get to know them. And even when you get to know them, you don't know them as well as you think you do. But I saw them as important and a priority, and I didn't run for office until after they were finished high school and away from home and independent. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, since people want me to run, they're insisting that I'm the one to do it, I ran and I won against three men and one woman. It was my time.
That was your season. This is your season. I hear that.
That was it.
I hear that. Let me turn to Ms. Jones, Valeisha, if I could ask the question, how was it growing up in the Butterfield household? What kind of mom was Mrs. Jean Farmer Butterfield? Give me a glimpse of a typical Saturday in the Butterfield home growing up.
My mom was and has always been a girl's girl. So I remember Saturdays shopping with my mom. We would shop until we dropped. Spending a lot of time in Thelma's hair salon, which was one of her best friends, did her hair every Saturday morning. Mm-hmm. And a lot of time with my grandmother, who she mentioned, Odell Shark Farmer, who was just the matriarch of our family and just an amazing, amazing just woman that I think we all, you know, saw as our model, you know, and who we aspire to be like. And so, you know, just lots of love from my mom, great advice. And she just, she's just still my best friend. You know, we talk almost every day. I know I can always get honest advice and sometimes hard advice when I need it, because she loves us so much that she just, you know, really believes in telling us the truth and doing it with love. So just an amazing, amazing person.
I love that. I love that. I love the family unit, but more especially the Black family unit. I can so relate to the going out on Saturday, shopping till you drop. Me and Mom just went and did pedicures this morning.
So. Exactly. That's our thing too.
Right.
Nails, pedicures.
Love
every
it.
Every time I come home to North Carolina, that's the first stop. We go and get our nails done.
There it is. And exactly. When we got home this afternoon, we called Dad on the phone because we were doing some online shopping. More shopping. And Dad literally said, I know y'all are happy because y'all are spending money.
Exactly.
We couldn't argue, so we cannot argue.
And the thing that's so amazing is that her husband, when he comes home, he goes and gets his manicure, pedicure, and the women there love him, so he fits right in the family.
Right.
The best thing is that he never does that anywhere else except when we come home to North Carolina. It's so funny.
Yeah, but that's good bonding time. Yeah. You know, those are those memories that you're going to build and that are like long lasting, you know? Mm-hmm.
So that's when I go in to get my nails done, they always ask about him.
Right. I don't know where he is. I understand that. So, Miss Valeisha, as a mother, daughter, basketball wife, global executive, motivational speaker, you've served as National Director of Diversity and Inclusion for the Alzheimer's Association, and I read that you formerly served as Global Head of Inclusion for Google, as well as National Director over the Youth Vote during the Obama campaign, and so many other positions, and now serving as the first not only as the first chief diversity and inclusion officer, but the first African-American woman, you know, we can't neglect that, for the Recording Academy, which is over the Grammys, if I'm not mistaken, correct?
Correct, yes.
Okay. So it's evident that you have a passion for enhancing the equal opportunities for the underrepresented class or groups across the entertainment industry and in technology and politics. So in a time when systemic racism is clearly or has clearly dictated how companies and our even our legal system and our government operate, it's important for us to definitely have a seat, you know, at the table when it comes to decisions and policies on how our nation is governed, even from equal opportunity employment, fair housing laws to our justice system. So my question to you, Valeisha, is what was the catalyst for you that planted you in the arena of diversity and inclusion?
You know, it's interesting. I, as a young girl, had this deep passion, as my mom knows, to work in the music industry. Okay. And that was always just something that, you know, I aspired to do behind the scenes. And I'll never forget my first job right out of college at 21 or 22 years old, you know, in New York City. I was kind of bitten by the social justice bug, if you will, while working in music, right? So it was one of those things that, you know, started as a passion for me, became a career path for me in music. But then once I entered that arena, I saw so much opportunity for me to drive change and equity and all the things that you just said with music as the platform. And so it really began 20 years ago with a laser focus on diversity, equity, and inclusion for, you know, our community. Mm-hmm. And it's now been a 20-year journey that now has a name and you know, it's now a hot career path for people to want to work in diversity and inclusion. But that work really began, you know, a long time ago with a few of us in the corporate space who said that it was time for change. Mm. And so now, you know, we've seen, even in recent weeks, an outcry, a very public outcry from our community and the world demanding change. And a part of that change includes in, you know, corporate spaces. And so I was very proud of the work that I did in the Obama administration that you mentioned and campaign. Very proud of the work that I did at Google. And when I saw the opportunity to join the Recording Academy, I was able to get right back to my music roots in such a serendipitous way. I never would have thought, you know, it would come full circle the way that it did. And I really think that music is a great unifier. And in moments like a pandemic and working from home, in moments like, you know, us, you know, just being tired and having enough, you know, of the injustice in our communities and in our prison systems and economically, you know, music has become a way to heal, a way to educate, and a way to drive change. And so I'm really proud to be in a space where, you know, I can be a part of the change and have a seat at the table. You know, I think that it's so important for any company who may be listening to make sure that they're looking at their leadership bench. And if they don't have a Black woman represented, that they do that now. And they do it in this calendar year, because I really think that change starts and begins at the top.
That's so good. That's so key that you say that it does start from the top. Those who are working in corporations and things like that, like you said, we have to be mindful to be inclusive. And, you know, even though I don't want to say that right now it's a fad, but, you know, it's important that we look at, like you said, the leadership board and those who are in position to make positive change in those policies and procedures and things like that, that were inclusive and representative of the nation, which is a huge melting pot. You know, it's not just one race, it's not just one culture, but that we hear and share with all ethnicities and things like that. So that's very important, very important. And Representative Butterfield, I know that you're so, so proud of all your daughters and their accomplishments. You yourself have much to be proud of, and I want to congratulate you again on your recent appointment by Governor Roy Cooper to the North Carolina Unemployment Board. And I know that you'll bring a substantial impact to that board as well, that how you served your community and North Carolina over the years. I know that you'll continue to do the same in your new role. And so given the years of service and even now in your new role, that you'll serve North Carolinians, what is your hope for tomorrow? What's the legacy that you hope to leave for your children and your grandchildren?
I think that being a public servant and serving in the North Carolina General Assembly for almost 18 years, and then having the honor of being recognized and appointed by the governor to be on the Board of Review for Unemployment, I think the legacy I like to leave is that you can accomplish anything that you set your mind to. You have to put in the time and the hard work and make sure that you earn what comes your way. It just doesn't happen. You got to reach out for it and make it happen. I think it's important that everybody has a legacy that's positive so that they can pass it on to their children and grandchildren. And I've always felt like being genuine, sincere, honest, and hardworking. I think my mother's theme was "Let the work I've done speak for me." That was one of her favorite songs. And that had an impact on me. And I think my grandmother, who was my mother's mother, also used that same theme in her actions in life. She lived it. And I felt like it was important for me to live a life that would make my family proud and speak for me in a positive light so that I could be an example for others, not just my children and grandchildren, but children and grandchildren of all people of all races and nationalities and origin. I think it's important that you give back to whom much is given, much is required. My family was always blessed and able to help others, and I saw that growing up, and I wanted to make a difference. So I'm grateful for all the things that people have done for us. Every time there's been a crisis or a critical issue in my family's life, people have come and rallied around us and supported us. So I felt like it was only right and just that I do the same and make a difference in the world. I think that the recent death of former Congressman John Lewis, who I had the pleasure of meeting, said that it's okay to have good trouble. And I like to be a part of good trouble.
Yes.
And to me, good trouble is looking out at the world and finding out what needs to be done and doing your part, no matter how small or how large, to make a difference in the lives of others and putting them first and foremost in whatever you do. And along the way, if you do that, good things come back to you in return.
Amen.
And that's been my experience.
Amen. That's good. That's good meat for the soul.
And I like I'm very proud of my two daughters. I have two daughters, Valeisha and Lene, and Lene is the youngest and could not be here today.
Yes.
I try to live the kind of life that I wanted them to see as a role model, an example for them to use in their path in life. And I'm just so proud that they're both using the path that I paid for them and my mother paid for me and my grandmother paid for my mother. And the legacy goes on and on.
Amen. Amen. They come from good cloth, as they say.
And my mother always said that she wanted her daughters and granddaughters to grow up and be independent and able to fend for themselves no matter what happened in life. It's kind of like she used to say, God bless the child who has his or her own.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been something that has been important to me, to have my own and be able to take what I've been able to accumulate and share to spread it with others.
Amen.
And I do that in every aspect of my life, personal and professional and as a public servant.
Right. And it shows.
Thank you.
It shows. Ms. Valeisha, if I could ask, you worked with the Obama campaign prior to him taking office and after office, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
But you served on the national level as far as that youth vote is concerned. It's election year. We're counting down the days to November 3rd. And you know, sometimes there's discouragement when it comes to voter registration, and even those who are registered, they're doubtful. You know, we have to be mindful of the wiles of voter suppression and recognize the schemes of voter suppression. So understanding or what I recognize as being one of the greatest, I think, social media campaigns as far as elections go, when it came to President Obama's campaign, it was one of the largest social media campaigns as far as the vote is concerned. What can you share with us that could help us encourage the voter, even those who are still not registered? And my heart goes out, my mind goes out, my energy wants to be poured out to that non-voter that's not registered right now, to implore them that your voice is your vote. Your vote does count. If your vote didn't count, if it didn't matter, they wouldn't try so hard to suppress you to not vote. Mm-hmm. So what can you share with us to help us be encouraged, not be doubtful, in your walks as far as it relates to the polls?
Well, I'll say this. I served in President Obama's 2012 reelection campaign. And prior to that, I served in his first term in the Obama administration. And still, I would say to any young person listening that this election cycle, right, the one that we're facing in less than 100 days, is arguably the most important one that we will see in our lifetime, right? And you know, while I, you know, never would have or could have imagined that we would elect in our lifetime our first Black president, I never thought that I would have the opportunity to work for our first Black president. Still, I say again that this is arguably the most important election season of our lifetime. Mm-hmm. And so for any young person, I cannot say enough how important it is for you to register to vote. The voter suppression tactics that you just talked about are very real, mm-hmm. right? We're seeing it play out every single day.
Right.
And this is how we take our power, right? And this is how we as young people, and for young people under 40 and all people, this is how we, you know, drive the real change that we want to see at the federal level and at the local level. Right. I should say that is important too. Right. And so, you know, for young people, I think, you know, sometimes we think that you're not paying attention, but I know that you are, right? I think that sometimes we underestimate the interest and the savviness of our young people because they are watching and they are paying attention and they are focused on the issues. But I would just, you know, really ask that you take that next step if you haven't yet and register to vote and use your voice on election day. But then I'll also say to, you know, our organizers out there and our elected officials and, you know, folks who are, you know, either at the grassroots level or, you know, who are, you know, within political campaigns and structures to also do your part, right? What we did in 2012 on the Obama campaign was very much an art and a science, right? The art of it was beautiful language like change, right? Mm. Beautiful language like believe, you know, and all the things. But behind that operation, and I was a part of it, was a very smart effort around technology, around data collection, and really having very focused, targeted, authentic engagement with young people in our organizing efforts.
Right.
And so, you know, young people do your part, but those, you know, organizers, you know, also do your part and make sure that we're not taking the youth vote for granted, you know, that we are making sure that young people are a part of the agenda that you're right. setting for and that you're speaking, you know, to the issues of, you know, young people in our future, right? Because those are the things that they're listening for. You know, what is our, you know, what are we doing around education? What are we doing to make sure that we have proper technology and computers in our schools and having, you know, equal access to quality education and all of those things? And so I would say, you know, let's make sure that we, you know, strengthen the partnership that we have with young people and really engage them and make sure that they too have a seat at the table.
And let me interject here that more so than ever, every age group at every level needs to be involved. And it's real simple. If you look at the pandemic and what's happening with health disparities, the fact that Hispanics and African Americans are disproportionately affected more than others, there's a reason for it. The pre-existing conditions that they have, health care, people don't have insurance.
Right.
That's a no-brainer. Had they had insurance, many of those pre-existing conditions would not exist.
Right.
They could have had prevention and intervention, but instead they have pre-existing conditions to no fault of theirs because they didn't have health insurance. So they were fearful of going to the doctor. They had to pick between paying mortgages or rent, food and medication, or going to the doctor. Okay. So we're talking about the pandemic here now. Everybody, it's real. People know that. We're talking about the economic downturn. People don't have jobs. People are trying to draw unemployment. And I'm dealing with that now in my new role on the board. Right. We're talking about protests, peaceful protests, yet you have people sending in federal agents or troops to try to incite violence into what's going on. So I tell young people, choose facts over fake news and fiction.
Yeah.
Choose respect over disrespect. Choose unity over division. Choose love over hate. And you will choose Biden over Trump. And that in itself is enough reason to get out and vote from the national level all the way down to the local. Look at people who think like you do, who advocate for you and put you first, and who you are accountable to and they are accountable to you. Simple as that. Do your part.
That's good.
Good trouble.
Good trouble. Necessary trouble. I like that. And take someone with you to the polls.
There you go.
And wait in the line. Like, I just want to say to anyone listening, the lines will be long. So if you can early vote. If you can mail in vote. But if you have to stand in the line, please stand in the line. Right? It's so worth it. So just make sure that you do your part and just know it won't be easy. They're going to make every attempt that they can to get us to turn away. But it's going to be worth it in the end.
It will be worth
it. And people have actually died, shed blood, sweat, and tears for the right to vote.
Right.
Who were our ancestors, so why would you do any less than that?
Right.
I have a sister who was ill with cancer and under medical treatment, and she went to the polls and had to be carried on someone's back to actually vote. But it was just that important to her because she knew her history and she understood the importance of voting.
Right.
So that's the legacy we have to carry on. Good trouble. Let it be good trouble.
Right. And it starts with education.
Yes.
Voter education. It really does. Stressing Absolutely. The importance of it. And like you said, too many have, you know, fought, bled, and died for our right, for this God-given right. We can stand in line for 30 minutes.
There you go.
So
there you go.
We can.
And one time you were a slave and you couldn't vote.
Mm-hmm.
And you worked and got no pay or very little pay, if any.
Right.
That's your history. Remember your history.
There it is.
It's not that way anymore. Now you don't get in your own way.
Miss Butterfield's about to preach, y'all.
I'm ready to preach.
Yes, ma'am. I want to divert from the script just a little bit because our time is drawing near. But I do have a quick little game I want the three of us to play. I was hoping Lene was going to be able to join us today because some of the questions are about siblings, but we can still play. We can still play. And I know y'all have heard of this game. It's called Never Have I Ever.
Yes. And I don't know this one.
Okay. Well, let me explain the rules really quick. I'm going to ask a series of questions. Never have I ever. And if you have not, you do nothing. But if you have, if I ask the question, just touch your nose. And I'm going to put a precursor out there, Valeisha. Miss Butterfield, this is a safe zone. Any answers, cannot, shall not, will not, there will not be any repercussion for any answers.
I hope that's for real.
No repercussions. This is a safe zone. Safe zone.
Okay, so if I touch my nose, that means I have never ever?
That means if you touch your nose, that means you have.
Okay, that's it. I got it. Okay.
All right. First question. Never have I ever snuck out after curfew. Okay, y'all are going to have to say something because actually they're not going to see it on the podcast. So, Valeisha. Okay.
I absolutely snuck out more times than my mom knows. We lived on a beautiful house on Vance Street in Wilson, North Carolina, and our back had a sliding glass door that would just very quietly open. And so I definitely snuck out more, and I'm sorry, Bob.
Never have I ever done that.
You never done? Well, I've never done it. The stairs in my parents' house, too noisy, doors were never oiled, and that may have been intentional.
Yeah, our stairs did creak.
Okay, second question. Never have I ever done something that I knew was wrong and blame my sibling for it.
I have never done that.
Never done that? Good.
My brother blamed me, though, for something he did.
I can honestly say me and my sister have never, well, as far as I know, she's never blamed me for anything, but I can honestly say I've never blamed her for anything I've done. I was too scared. I was kind of the goody-goody.
Me too.
I was the scared. Yeah.
And my mother said I never gave her a day of trouble, and I didn't.
Well, that's good.
Or my dad, so.
Never have I ever been half-dressed and worn pajama bottoms during a Zoom call.
I have done that.
Sure. I might be doing it right now, but I won't reveal the truth.
In fact, I went to the bowling alley one time that Valeisha and Lene, my two daughters, broke the curfew at the skating rink. That's what it was, wasn't it, Valeisha?
Yes, it was.
And I went out there with hair rollers on. They were embarrassed. Night clothes on, the robe, everything.
After life. I'm still scarred.
Walked in the place.
And I bet that was the last time they broke
the curfew. That was the talk of town.
I'm pretty sure that was. Well, mm-hmm. thank you, ladies. I love all of my guests that come
thank
on
you.
Here chat with us for the Truth and the Soul Journey. But I must say that y'all have been like the most heartwarming, because y'all truly do remind me of me and my mom.
Thank you.
Like I love the family unit, the Black family unit. And I just want to thank the both of you for fighting for our culture and how you fight for equality and inclusion. And I just salute the both of you, and I'm proud to know you and all the
thank
work that
you
and families are doing to ensure a better tomorrow for us all. So thank you.
Well, I just
thank
want to
you,
say,
Maya. It's nice seeing you.
Nice yes, seeing you. Thank you.
Love you, Valeisha.
I want to say thank you to Maya for elevating and amplifying our voices and this beautiful platform that you've created. So just thank you for even inviting us on and all the great work that you do in Sojourner Truth's name. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I appreciate that. Thank you so
all
much.
All right. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
Love you.
Respect us, no, they won't. Boy, don't even try to touch us. Boy,